Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The topic of today's lecture is dermatomyositis. And you all know that dermatomyositis is a very important subject. Dermatomyositis is an autoimmune disorder affecting predominantly skin and skeletal muscle. And it is classified along with polymyositis in the category of idiopathic inflammatory myopathies, abbreviated as IIM. The Bone and Peter classification of dermatomyositis that is introduced in 1975, but is still workable and is being used. This criteria does not acknowledge the amyopathic dermatomyositis and fail to distinguish polymyositis with inclusion body myositis. Therefore, the GRIPS criteria for inclusion body myositis may be used in addition. But since the inclusion body myositis does not concern the dermatologist, so this criteria is not being discussed in this lecture. The Bone and Peter classification of polymyositis and dermatomyositis. So this classification embodies four muscle criteria and one skin criterion. The muscle criteria include symmetrical proximal muscle weakness. This is a clinical criteria. Then two laboratory criteria, that is muscle biopsy and elevated serum muscle enzymes, and one EMG criteria, that is EMG evidence of myositis. The fifth criteria is the typical rash of dermatomyositis. In polymyositis, since there is no skin involvement, the diagnosis revolves in the first four criteria. So if all the first four criteria, which are the muscle criteria, are positive, then the diagnosis is definitive. If any three of the criteria are positive, then the diagnosis is probable. And if two of the criteria are positive, that is the muscle criteria, then the diagnosis is possible. On the side of dermatomyositis, and criteria number five, that is typical rash of dermatomyositis, is must. So if the typical rash of dermatomyositis is present plus any three of the four muscle criteria, then it is definitive. Skin rash plus any two of the muscle criteria, then it is probable. And typical rash plus any one of the four criteria, then it is possible. First of all, we'll discuss the amyopathic dermatomyositis. Amyopathic dermatomyositis is a subset of dermatomyositis that is characterized by biopsy-confirmed cutaneous finding of dermatomyositis occurring 6 months or longer, but no clinical evidence of proximal muscle weakness and no serum muscle enzyme abnormalities. So a proven skin rash of dermatomyositis with no muscle involvement. If extensive or repeated muscle testing are done, some of the tests may become positive or abnormal. Hence, such cases can be called as hypomyopathic dermatomyositis. The exclusion criteria for amyopathic dermatomyositis must be that the patient of dermatomyositis should not have received any immunosuppressive medicine for the first for two consecutive months, which would have treated the myositis part of the disease. Or the exclusion criteria include that the patient must not have used the drug that can cause a dermatomyositis-like rash, and the drug typically is hydroxyurea. So in such cases, the patient is erroneously diagnosed as dermatomyositis. However, it would be a drug-induced rash. So there is another term which is called as the clinically amyopathic dermatomyositis that would embody both amyopathic and hypomyopathic dermatomyositis. This figure which is shown in the slide is a very interesting figure. This figure has amyopathic dermatomyositis on the left side and polymyositis and inclusion body myositis on the right side. And there are two triangles, the first showing the muscle and the other showing the skin. And as depicted in the figure, there will be muscle involvement and no skin involvement on the right side, where it will be called as polymyositis or inclusion body myositis. And there is a skin involvement with no muscle involvement on the left side, when it is called as amyopathic dermatomyositis. While the middle part is an overlap between muscle involvement and skin involvement, and this middle part is the dermatomyositis. In dermatomyositis, autoimmune inflammatory damage of the skin, muscle, and in certain cases, internal organ, such as lung, joint, oropharynx, and the heart. The interstitial lung disease is one of the common complications of dermatomyositis, and it affects such patients irrespective of muscle skin phenotype. The myositis specific antibodies can predict the phenotype and internal organ involvement, although such antibodies are not readily available in all laboratories. Mortality is increased in dermatomyositis, and it is slightly more in dermatomyositis as compared to polymyositis. The 10-year survival is in the range of 90%. You should all remember that the main cause of mortality in inflammatory myopathies are the cardiac disease, respiratory disease, and malignancy. Epidemiology. Several epidemiological studies have shown the prevalence, shows the incidence between 0.1 to 6.7 per 100,000. And there is an association of association between UV exposure and the rash of dermatomyositis and presence of MI2 antibodies. There are two a peak of ages, there are two ages in which dermatomyositis is seen. The first is in childhood range before the age of 10 years, and the other, the adult, is between 40 to 60 years. Female are affected twice as often as male, and female preponderance in children is greater than 5:1. Ethnicity, dermatomyositis is seen more in African Americans than white Americans. Association with malignancy is an important one. Dermatomyositis in adults is very closely associated with malignancies, round about 50%. And the malignancies that are commonly associated include the solid organ malignancies like CA ovary, CA breast, CA lung, CA colon, then non-Hodgkin lymphoma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma. The juvenile dermatomyositis is not thought to be associated with higher risk of malignancy. The risk of malignancy rises with increase in age at the onset of the disease, patient having severe disease with necrotic lesions, patient complaining of dysphagia and diaphragmatic weakness, and lack of extra muscular systemic features, for example, inflammatory lung disease, or antibodies to anti-transcription intermediate factor 1 gamma, anti-transcription intermediate factor 1 gamma, or nuclear matrix protein 2, NXP2. So these two antibodies increases the risk of having a malignant association. Neoplasm may be identified in patients before, at, or after the onset of dermatomyositis. In one study, 58% of malignancy present after the diagnosis of dermatomyositis. The risk of cancer is greatest in first few years after the diagnosis, and a lower risk more than 5 years after diagnosis. Pathophysiology. An early histological feature of dermatomyositis in muscle, which is not found in polymyositis, is the deposition of membrane attack complex
component component known as C5B-9 within the capillaries. In perifascicular areas, muscle fiber atrophy occurs. The inflammatory infiltrate comprises mainly of B cells and CD4 positive T cells, macrophages, and plasmatoid dendritic cells, which are found predominantly perivascular and perifascicular areas. In contrast to polymyositis, there is evidence of cell-mediated cytotoxicity with CD8 positive T cells invading the muscle fibers. Majority of patients will have the disease-associated autoantibodies, and the myositis specific, there are two types of disease-associated autoantibodies, the myositis specific and myositis associated. So the myositis specific antibodies include anti-MI2, anti-JO1, TIF1-gamma, MDA5, and SUMO activating enzyme. While myositis associated antibodies include anti-52 kilodalton RO, U1-RNP, PMSCL, and KU. Two of the myositis-specific antibodies, which are MDA5 and anti-JO1, titer show some correlation with disease activity. So if we have to check the disease activity pattern, then we can order serially the MDA2 or anti-JO1 antibodies. Several myositis autoantigens, which include MI2 and KU, and the aminoacyl transferase RNA synthetase are upregulated in diseased muscles. MI2 expression increased specifically in dermatomyositis, but not in polymyositis. So MI2 shows some disease specificity as compared to other antibodies. Histological features. Usually the histological appearances of all the autoimmune disorders is the same, which are characterized by interface change, that is the basal cell degeneration. You cannot see any basal cell there. There are colloid bodies, there is pigmentary incontinence, but there is no band-like inflammatory infiltrate, which is seen in lichenoid dermatosis. In acute dermatomyositis, the changes resemble those of subacute lupus erythematosus, although the dermal edema may be more extensive in dermatomyositis. In poikilodermatous variety of dermatomyositis, there is an epidermal atrophy, dilated small blood vessels superficially, and melanin incompetence. In Gautran's papule, it is the hyperkeratosis, acanthosis, and papillomatosis. Unusual skin biopsy findings in unusual skin rashes include subepidermal blistering, dystrophic calcification, and lobular paniculitis. Muscles. Cellular infiltrate containing lymphocytes are seen predominantly in perivascular and perifascicular areas. Perivascular and perifascicular areas. Muscle fibers show perifascicular atrophy. Clinical features, history. The dermatomyositis is the presenting feature in over 50% of the dermatomyositis cases. Dermatosis is the presenting feature in over 50% of dermatomyositis cases. And most patients develop a facial rash accompanied by edema. There may be scalp involvement with hair loss in early stages, and a rash on hands and extensive surfaces of limbs and upper torso tend to occur subsequently. Eruption of dermatomyositis can be pruritic or can have a burning sensation. And there are only a few patients which will give a clear history of photosensitivity. The muscle disease in dermatomyositis become clinically apparent in weeks to months after the onset of skin rash. So it is not usually the first finding. It follows the skin finding. The initial symptom of myositis is weakness and fatigue. It's a generalized weakness and generalized fatigue. But later on, the patient will have difficulty in climbing stairs, that is using the proximal muscle of the lower limb, raising their arms, upper limb, and standing from sitting position, lower limb. There may be myalgia, but muscle tenderness is relatively rare. That is important. If untreated, the weakness will usually progress over a matter of weeks, with severe loss of power may result and patient becoming bedbound. Then the respiratory muscle involvement starts and can lead to respiratory failure. And problem with swallowing and symptoms of aspiration, which reflects the involvement of pharyngeal and upper esophageal musculature and indicates aggressive course and poor prognosis. Other clues to aggressive disease include weight loss, recurrent respiratory tract infections, and quiet nasal voice. Raynaud's phenomena is relatively common, but is seen particularly associated with antisynthetase syndrome and mixed connective tissue disease, and it is rare in childhood cases. Joint involvement, which is an important complication, occur in one quarter of the cases and presents as generalized arthralgia and morning stiffness, not arthritis. So this slide shows the presenting skin signs in patients of dermatomyositis. So the classical cutaneous signs include a facial rash, which is a confluent erythema of the whole face. This is an acute finding, an acute rash. Then eyelid erythema with edema, which is typically called as the heliotrope rash. Nail fold changes, Gautran's papule, rash on upper chest and back, scalp erythema with hair loss, flagellate erythema, vasculopathic ulcers, which are called as the mechanic's hand and seen in antisynthetase syndrome, poikiloderma and cutaneous calcinosis. Alternatively, a lupus erythematosus like malar rash and seborrheic dermatitis like eruption is also seen in patients of dermatomyositis. So this is the acute facial rash, a generalized erythema, and sometimes associated with edema. Heliotrope rash involves the eyelid skin and is pathognomic of dermatomyositis. Upper eyelid is the preferable site with erythema that is lilac in color, as you can see the color of the slide, or heliotrope, which is a lilac colored flower. This distinctive hue is only appreciable in fair skin individuals, while in dark skin individuals, this typical lilac color will not be obvious. It may be interpreted differently. Edema of eyelids and periorbital skin may occur. So this is a typical heliotrope rash, the upper eyelid edema. Another picture of heliotrope rash. Fixed macular erythema commonly appears on upper torso, both the V of the chest and across the shoulder, where it is called as the shawl sign. If untreated, rash of dermatomyositis become poikilodermatous with predominant features of poikiloderma, that is skin atrophy and telangiectasias and color alteration. Rarely acute rash may be seen with vesicular or bullous eruption. This rash signifies an aggressive disease phenotype. Then paniculitis is a rare cutaneous manifestation, and patient presents with large zones of painful, deep-seated inflammation occur mainly on the proximal limbs, both upper and lower, and these lesions may ulcerate. This is a typical shawl sign, that is erythematous rash on the shoulders. Gautran papule are inflammatory, lilac color, flat top, lichenoid lesions that occur on the skins overlying the distal and proximal interphalangeal joints of the fingers and metacarpophalangeal joints. So mainly over the joints. Similar larger lesions may occur on the elbows and knees, and rarely on palmar surfaces of the finger. And when such papules occur on the flexor aspects of or the palmar aspects, they are called as the inverse Gautran papules. Examination of back of hands may also reveal linear red streaks on the skin overlying the extensor tendons. Hand edema may also occur. So this is a typical Gautran papules. You can see on the metacarpophalangeal joints and both on the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints. These are the Gautran papules, the violaceous, flat-topped, lily-colored papules. Nail fold changes. Nail fold changes are important in all the autoimmune disorders. The most typical nail findings are seen in systemic sclerosis, but after systemic sclerosis, dermatomyositis stand at the number two, and it is characterized by periungual erythema with visible dilated capillary loops in proximal nail folds, small hemorrhagic infarcts, and dystrophic or ragged cuticles. The nail fold changes in dermatomyositis are indistinguishable from those seen in other connective tissue disease. You can see there are splinter hemorrhages, nail hemorrhages. The cuticle is not that disturbed here. And here they're typically ragged cuticles and periungual telangiectasias, Raynaud's phenomena. Buttocks are often involved in dermatomyositis with erythema and edema, and this on the side of the thighs. Erythema and edema on the side of the thigh is typically called as the Holster sign. Vasculopathic ulcers. Distinctive vasculopathic ulcers tend to be punched out, surrounded by a zone of dusky erythema, and occur in fingers and hands and extensor surfaces of elbow and knee. These typically vasculopathic ulcers are associated with antisynthetase syndrome, and the typical antibody here is anti-MDA5. Flagellate erythema is a strikingly cutaneous sign that is strongly associated with the diagnosis of dermatomyositis, and along with the other causes of flagellate dermatosis like bleomycin and ingestion of shiitake mushrooms. Characterized by multiple red macular streaks occurring on the trunk and proximal limbs, each streak is 1 centimeter in diameter and several centimeter in length. The stripes are aligned diagonally or crisscrossed, giving an appearance of whipping. Eruption can be sore or can be pruritic. In antisynthetase syndrome, a skin change which is called as mechanic's hand may be seen. The mechanic hand is the non-inflammatory hyperkeratosis occurring on the hands and feet, usually over the lateral surfaces of the fingers and outer border of the feet. These are the hyperkeratosis, which is seen in a subset of dermatomyositis called as the antisynthetase or syndrome or mechanic's hand. Calcinosis cutis. Calcinosis cutis in autoimmune inflammatory dermatosis include two causes, the systemic sclerosis and dermatomyositis. And it is seen as a complication of dermatomyositis in which calcified material is deposited in the skin and subcutaneous tissue. Calcinosis occur in 10% of adult dermatomyositis patient, typically with anti-NXP2 antibodies. These lesions are painful and may be functionally disabling, and the skin may ulcerate over the calcinosis areas. Then the muscle signs. Proximal myopathies and patients frequently present with problem climbing the stairs, getting out of the chairs, performing tasks that require lifting of hands above the head, such as brushing hairs. The onset of weakness is, however, insidious, slow onset. Even in patients who do not complain of weakness, muscle strength should be assessed by manual muscle testing. Brief screen for muscle involvement can be made by assessing the hip flexion, shoulder abduction, and elbow extension. And usually this muscle power is graded in Medical Research Council grade 0 to 5. There are other sensitive muscle assessment grades, but these are not of clinical significance. respiratory and other systemic feature. The respiratory compromise in dermatomyositis is caused by inflammatory lung disease, by respiratory muscle weakness, or aspiration in patient with dysphagia or due to immunosuppression. Patient present with cough and exertional dyspnea and have fine late inspiratory crepitations on chest auscultation. So always auscultate chest in a patient of dermatomyositis. In majority of inflammatory lung disease present with non-specific interstitial pneumonitis. Generally, a cryptogenic organizing pneumonia has a very good prognosis responding rapidly to steroids, but in context with dermatomyositis are more sinister, fibrosing form may occur. Diffuse alveolar damage is usually a severe disorder and carries a poor prognosis and may lead to mortality complications. The oropharynx and upper esophageal sphincter are frequently affected in dermatomyositis causing dysphagia. So early detection will prevent the chances of aspiration. While mild cardiac abnormality such as minor rhythm disturbance is frequent, but overt disease which that manifests as cardiac failure is rare. And cardiac failure due to myocarditis responds to immunosuppressions. A symmetrical non-deforming arthritis may develop, usually affecting the small joints of hands or wrist and ankle. In antisynthetase syndrome, a more aggressive or erosive arthritis may occur as a presenting sign. So aggressive arthritis is associated with antisynthetase syndrome, which is a subset of dermatomyositis. There are certain clinical variants. The mixed connective tissue disease is an overlap connective tissue disease characterized by high titer anti-RNP antibodies, Raynaud's phenomena, sclerodactyly, inflammatory myositis, inflammatory lung disease, and pulmonary hypertension. So mixed feature between dermatomyositis and scleroderma. Antisynthetase syndrome, which is already coming up several times before, occurs in the presence of antisynthetase antibodies. The most commonly antihistidyl transferase RNA synthetase antibody is anti-JO1 antibody, which is found in 10 to 20% of dermatomyositis cases. There are 7 other antisynthetase antibodies which are not required to be remembered. Just remember the main antibody, that is anti-JO1. It is characterized by, the antisynthetase syndrome is characterized by myositis and arthritis and Raynaud's phenomena. So myositis with arthritis and Raynaud's plus inflammatory lung disease occurring in 75% of the cases, fever and acral skin signs, rather than the heliotropic rash or the facial edema or the got, most signs are on the hands, which include the mechanic hands and sometimes Gautrin papules. The non-anti-JO1 patients have lower frequency of myositis and slightly higher incidence of inflammatory lung disease than JO1 positive patients. Juvenile dermatomyositis may be considered as dermatomyositis that presents before 10 years of age. Unlike adult dermatomyositis, there does not seem to be increased association with malignancy. However, calcinosis is more common in 6 to 50%. And 4 different forms of calcinosis occur. That is the superficial cutaneous or subcutaneous, intramuscular calcinosis involving the myofascial planes, and extensive encasing calcinosis forming an exoskeleton. Then lipodystrophy is a feature of juvenile dermatomyositis and not of adult onset dermatomyositis. So you can see in this radiograph, the calcinosis around the elbow joint and lipoatrophy in this patient. It is associated with insulin resistant type 2 diabetes and acanthosis nigricans, which can be general, partial, or focal. Antibody frequency and phenotype association differs somewhat between adult and juvenile, For example, anti-GO1 occur in around 20% in adult myositis, but occur only very rarely in juvenile dermatomyositis. Then clinically amyopathic dermatomyositis, that includes both the amyopathic and hypomyopathic, characterized by presence of cutaneous manifestations and absence of clinical signs of muscle involvement. Despite of lack of muscle and myositis, patients are at risk of developing cancer and inflammatory lung disease. The anti-MDA5 antibodies are found at higher frequency in clinically amyopathic dermatomyositis patients. Consequently, it is important to make a thorough assessment of inflammatory lung disease in patients with amyopathic disease. Drug-induced dermatomyositis is attributed to several adverse drug reactions. Hydroxycarbamide is a culprit in 50% of the cases. None of the hydroxycarbamide patient has evidence of myositis and only have evidence of dermatitis. Clinically, hydroxycarbamide cases are characterized by violaceous lichenoid and scaly eruption on back of fingers and dorsum of hands and top of feet and elbow. And this eruption is like the Gottlieb papule, but can be atrophic and perclerodermatous. Histologically, there is hydropic degeneration on dyskeratotic cells at the basal layer and lichenoid lymphocytic infiltrate, dilated blood vessels, and best described as hydroxycarbamide dermatopathy. This improves within 12 months of stopping the drug. Classification of severity of dermatomyositis is done by using a dermatomyositis skin severity index, DSSI, which is calculated from the visual inspection of the skin in four major body areas, quantifying redness in duration and scaling. In same way, we do PASI score. But this score is mainly used for research purposes. There are other muscle scores as well, which include the MITx or MyoACT, but you are not supposed to remember these scales. So the skin rash of dermatomyositis looks like lupus erythematosus, seborrheic dermatitis, rosacea, allergic contact dermatitis, psoriasis, sometimes lichen planus or lichenoid drug eruption, and cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. So these all can be included in the differential diagnosis. Complications and comorbidities. Patient with severe muscle weakness develop hypoventilatory respiratory failure. And such cases, monitoring is done by forced vital capacity, FVC, serially at bedside. Another measure is a SNP, nasal inspiration pressure, called as SNP. Patient with low SNP or forced vital capacity, then pulse oximetry should be done overnight to assess any nocturnal hypoventilation. Involvement of oropharynx or nasopharynx pharyngeal sphincter would lead to dysphagias. Aspiration pneumonia is a common complication which is exacerbated by respiratory muscle weakness and dysphagia. Inflammatory cardiomyopathy may occur in dermatomyositis, and cardiovascular disease incidence is higher in dermatomyositis in some cases. And in order to minimize the risk factors for severe disease or complication, it is advisable to patient to reduce weight, to check the blood pressure and hypercholesterolemias, and restrict the steroid therapy and stop smoking. The disease course and prognosis. The disease course is variable, with majority of patients requiring ongoing long-term immunosuppression. Around 20 to 35% of surviving myositis patients have a monophasic illness, and around 20 to 30% follows a relapsing remitting course and remainder following a chronic course. So 20 to 35% are monophasic illness, 20 to 30% relapsing and remitting course, and rest about for 40 or 50% have a chronic continuous course. Prognosis relates closely to the systemic features, with cancer and inflammatory lung disease being two major causes of death. The modern series, a 10-year survival is in a range of 90%. Investigations. Patient with suspected dermatomyositis should have a full biochemical profile, full blood count, ESR, inflammatory markers, and muscle enzymes. The muscle enzymes include creatinine kinase, aldolase, aspartate aminotransferase, and lactic dehydrogenase, four different enzymes. Then 24 hours urinary creatinine excretion is high, and following serological tests are performed, anti-nuclear antibody, extractable nuclear antigens, and double-stranded DNA. Lupus anticoagulant, complement, anti-cardiolipin antibody, and beta-2 glycoprotein 1 antibody. Approximately 80% of dermatomyositis patients have positive anti-nuclear antibody, or often in low titer. Myositis-associated antibodies are antibodies that occur in myositis but are not specific for it. 20% of the inflammatory, idiopathic inflammatory myopathies cases may be found in conjunction with other myopathic antibodies, particularly the anti-JO1, anti-KU, anti-U1-RNP, U3-RNP, and PMSCL. But these antibodies, the last few antibodies, occur in overlap syndromes with scleroderma features. Antisynthetase antibody, the commonest is anti-JO1. Antisynthetase antibodies are rare in juvenile dermatomyositis, has already been told. Antibodies to MDA5 is found in patient with clinically amyopathic dermatomyositis and in inflammatory lung disease in 92% of the patients. And MDA5 antibodies is typically associated with vasculopathic ulcers on the finger, knuckles, elbows, and knees. Then anti-T1F1 gamma is associated with cancer, and anti-NXP2 is associated with calcinosis. Anti-MI2 antibody is found in 10 to 20% of the cases, and such patients generally have classical cutaneous features of dermatomyositis, including Gautran's papule, heliotrope rash, and Scholl sign and upper chest erythema. Muscle disease tend to be mild, and inflammatory lung disease rare in patient having anti-MI2 antibodies. Anti-sumo activating enzymes occur in 8% of adult dermatomyositis and having increased frequency of dysphagias. Electromyography differentiates myopathies from neuropathies with early recruitment of multiple small amplitudes, short duration motor unit potentials. MRI of proximal muscles show edema suggesting but not diagnostic of muscle inflammation. When needed, muscle biopsy is to be performed prior to start of corticosteroid therapy to maximize the diagnostic yield. Plain radiograph is effective method of detecting the calcinosis. Inflammatory lung disease is major cause of mortality in dermatomyositis and should be actively screened. Lung function tests like forced ventilatory capacity, FEV1, forced expiratory volume in 1 second, and TLCO. High resolution CT scan chest, if lung function tests show restrictive pattern, then in view of increased risk of underlying tumors, screening for malignancy is necessary. There is no agreed protocol for the set of investigation, but generally CT scan of neck, thorax, abdomen, and pelvis should be performed in all patients who are to be excluded for internal organ malignancy. Then the management. The management of dermatomyositis is a combined effort of dermatologist, rheumatologist, and later on the respiratory medicine specialists. Systemic corticosteroids is the main or the cornerstone of the management of dermatomyositis, both with skin and muscle involvement. Oral prednisolone should be given in a dose of 0.5 to 1 milligram per kilogram and is effective in controlling symptoms. And many patients report improvement of rash and muscle weakness within 1 to 2 weeks of the start of corticosteroid therapy, in above dose, of course. With severe muscle disease and life-threatening complications, pulse intravenous methylprednisolone can be administered 500 mg to 1 gram daily for 3 consecutive days. The chronic nature of dermatomyositis, systemic corticosteroids are required for a prolonged period of time. So in such cases, the steroid-sparing drugs or immunosuppressants are to be added to control the inflammatory process and reduce the dose of prednisolone. And following drugs are used with varying benefit: azathioprine in 100 to 200 mg daily dose, methotrexate in 10 to 20 mg weekly dose, mycophenolate mofetil in 500 to 1500 mg twice daily dose, cyclosporin 3 to 5 mg per kg per day, and tacrolimus. Intravenous immunoglobulins can be used as disease-modifying therapy and an steroid-sparing agent. Patient is usually maintained on 25 milligram daily dose of prednisolone and given intravenous immunoglobulin at a dose of 2 gram per kg body weight monthly for 3 months. There are few published cases of effectiveness of rituximab in dermatomyositis. The usual dose is 1 gram rituximab administered 2 weeks apart show some partial response with reduction in muscle disease, and dermatomyositis did not improve. For the skin involvement, systemic corticosteroids in combination with steroid-sparing immunosuppressants are usually effective. However, complete clearance of dermatomyositis may take many months. In amyopathic dermatomyositis, aggressive immunosuppressive therapy seems inappropriate. So topical therapy and mild oral treatment should be tried. Benefits from topical tacrolimus 0.1% ointment is observed. Hydroxychloroquine alone or with mefacrine have been reported effective in clearing the cutaneous features. Methotrexate can be used for the management of skin disease, which is not responding otherwise. For calcinosis, aggressive early treatment of myositis may help in preventing the calcinosis, but once it occurs, calcium channel blockers like diltiazem 240 milligram BD is reported associated with gradual resolution of calcinosis in a small number of cases. Colchicine, eldronate, and warfarin have been shown to be of benefit, and sometimes surgical removal of the calcinosis is to be done. So that's all for today. Thank you all, and hope to see you next week with another edition of lecture on autoimmune inflammatory dermatosis. Goodbye, and thank you.